Good morning and welcome to the first meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. And I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the Standards Commission for Scotland annual report 2021 to 2022. And we're joined by Lorna Johnston, who's the Executive Director of Standards Commission for Scotland, and Sarah Nicholson, who's the Office Manager of Standards Commission for Scotland. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. And I invite Lorna to make a short opening statement.
Thank you. As the committee will be aware, the Standards Commission was established by the Ethical Standards in Public Life Scotland Act 2000. We're an independent public body responsible for encouraging high standards of conduct in public life in Scotland. The 2000 Act provides a framework under which ministers issue codes of conduct for councillors and members of public bodies, and the role of the Standards Commission is to promote those codes, to issue guidance on how the codes should be interpreted, and to adjudicate on alleged breaches of the codes, and where a breach is found, to apply a sanction. The Ethical Standards Commissioner is a separate and distinct office holder whose responsibilities include investigating complaints that councillors and members have breached their respective codes. The Commissioner sends a report to the Standards Commission on the conclusion of his investigation into complaints about councillors and members. On receipt of a report from the Commissioner, the Standards Commission has three options under the 2000 Act, which are either to hold a hearing, to direct the Commissioner to carry out further investigation, or to do neither, which essentially means that no further action will be taken on the complaint. Hearings conducted by a hearing panel comprising of three Standards Commission members are held, usually in public, to determine whether the councillor or member concerned has breached their respective code. If a breach is found, then the panel is obliged to impose a sanction, which can either be a censure, suspension, or, in the most serious cases, a disqualification. If the Standards Commission, having considered a referral report from the Commissioner, does not consider it's in the public and public interest and proportionate to hold a hearing, it will take no further action on the case. The parties to the complaint are advised, and a relatively short, anonymised written decision is published on the Standards Commission's website, outlining the reasoning and any learning points. The Standards Commission has one full-time member of staff, which is me. As the Executive Director, I'm the accountable officer. I'm assisted by a case manager, an office manager, an administrative assistant, all of whom are part-time, with the overall staffing complement being equivalent to 3.1 full-time members of staff. The Standards Commission has five part-time members appointed by the Parliamentary Corporation with the agreement of the Parliament. One of these, the convener, is contracted to work the equivalent of 3 days a month, while the remaining members work 2 days. And as previously noted, members also sit on hearing panels as and when required. So as the committee will have noted from our annual report for last year, the Standards Commission's strategic aims are to have a positive impact on ethical standards in public life, to pursue continuous improvement in the ethical standards framework and the way that we do our work, to pursue and develop strong relationships with our stakeholders, and to ensure all stakeholders have easy access to high quality information about the organisation, its work and any initiatives. So work undertaken last year to meet these aims included participating in a working group established by the government to review and revise the codes of conduct. That included analysing responses to the government's consultation on the proposed revised codes and amending their provisions in light of feedback and suggestions. And then following the consultation and issuing of the codes in December 2021, the Standards Commission produced, issued and published revised guidance and advice notes. We also produced and published standard training presentations and videos on the main changes to the code and on their key codes and on their key provisions. And in addition, we ran various training events and workshops to help promote awareness and understanding of the revised codes. So the Standards Commission established a good working relationship with the Acting Commissioner and worked with him to improve the processes for investigation and adjudication of complaints, with a view to trying to ensure consistency in the interpretation of the codes. We also undertook a review of lessons learned from the COVID pandemic and made various improvements to our governance and adjudication processes and arrangements. And despite an increase in the number of reports received from the Commissioner, the Standards Commission processed them ultimately. Decisions were made, issued and published on all no-action cases within 7 days of receipt of a report from the Commissioner. So in this year to date, we've continued to undertake outreach work to promote the codes. This has included presenting at Solar Annual Conference and providing tailored training sessions to the boards of several public bodies. We held our annual Monitoring Officers Workshop in October, which was attended by monitoring officers from councils all over Scotland, and we look forward to our annual Standards Officer Workshop in March. The Standards Commission has continued to update the case examples and illustrations in its guidance, advice notes and standard presentations in light of feedback and inquiries received and in light of decisions made. We've also developed and published interactive e-learning modules and animated videos on specific aspects of the code and the ethical standards framework. So I hope that's been a helpful introduction and summary of our remit and work, and I'm happy to answer any questions that the committee may have.
Thanks very much, Lorna. That is very helpful to have. It's so clearly laid out and to hear. I think something that comes across to me from your statement is the level of participation, engagement and feedback you seek in the work that you're doing. So that's very impressive. I'll open up to questions. I'm interested to... So in the Commission's strategic plan, one of the key objectives is to have a positive impact on ethical standards in public life. And I'd be interested to understand how that's measured. Can it be measured? And if so, do you have a sense that standards in public life are improving? And also related to this, what could you say about the levels of public trust in local politicians? Has trust improved in recent years?
Yep. The way we kind of measure our impact is we do surveys. We did surveys in 2022 of councillors and monitoring officers. And the reason we picked 2022 was we wanted to kind of get the views of outgoing councillors on the what they saw as the standards, whether standards had deteriorated, were improving, whether their colleagues had good understanding of the requirements of the code, whether they had experienced or witnessed bullying and harassment. And the same with monitoring officers, to try and get the views of council officers. And we did similar surveys of members of devolved public bodies and public body standards officers as well. We also tried to get... We kind of analyse the inquiries that we receive. We get a lot of inquiries about how the codes should be interpreted, and also inquiries about how complaints should be made, because quite often people confuse us with the Ethical Standards Commissioner as well. So we analyse those. We always seek feedback from our hearings. You know, so we've got various sources of information. The responses to the surveys were a bit mixed in terms of whether people feel that standards have improved or not. I think the kind of general view was that the vast majority of certainly councillors want to comply with the codes and are doing their best to do that. And it's sometimes, I think, the issues that crop up the most, the respect and bullying and harassment, especially respect, it can sometimes just be perhaps someone losing their temper or not thinking things through. But we've certainly noticed in the last sort of 5 years or so that we're having far less inadvertent breaches of the codes of conduct, you know, ones where it's maybe a failure to register an interest within, you know, the time limit, the month that you get to register a new interest, whatever it is. So it seems to be, I think that demonstrates that perhaps there is a greater understanding of the codes, and that the breaches we're seeing now tend to be much more about more behaviour like bullying and harassment rather than a failure to declare interests or... trying to take advantage of your position or, anything to do with gifts and hospitality, that kind of thing.
Okay, great. Thanks. So following on from that, actually, so you talked there about how you did this outgoing survey in 2022 with outgoing councillors. But I'd be interested to hear what work you've done since May, since the local elections, to ensure the new councillors are familiar with their code of conduct. And you also mentioned in your opening statement that you've been doing quite a bit of work around training and creating e-learning modules.
Yeah, so we were really keen to get our updated guidance and advice out at the same time as the codes and when they were issued in 2021, which we did, and that meant that they were all in place in time for the new councillors coming in after the election. And we also put in place the standard training presentation, so we knew we wouldn't be able to get around all 32 councils, but it meant that monitoring officers and other council staff could use our... we did videos, we did standard PowerPoint presentations on on the code and the revised code, and also on the key changes to the code. So we're trying to put in place materials that they could use. Obviously, new councillors get a lot of information sort of thrown at them at the beginning. So we thought putting those in place would give councils the chance to decide when the best time to do that induction was. Since then, we kind of see our guidance and advice notes as kind of moving documents, because we want them to be as fit for purpose as possible. So we update them in light of, we get told about scenarios maybe by officers or by councillors, when we get inquiries, and we update our case examples and scenarios in those documents to try and make sure they're as relevant as possible. We've been working on e-learning modules. So we've got two in place, and we're hoping to publish another two by the end of this financial year. One's on the applicability of the code when it applies, and the other one is on identifying and managing conflicts of interest. So two topics that we think it would help for councillors to work their way through, that hopefully the interactive e-learning module helps them do that.
Yeah, that's brilliant. It's good to hear. And it's also good to hear this awareness that you have that when councillors are first elected, they're overwhelmed by information. So you're giving that flexibility as to when councillors can share that information and say, look, this is something that's important for you to pay attention to.
Yeah, and I think it's also where some of the feedback that we got in surveys was that some of our advice notes and guidance in the past have been a bit unwieldy, a bit, the Word documents that, and some people just don't, that's not their best way of learning. So we are trying to improve that and trying to make all our guidance and advice notes more accessible, have them in different formats. Just make them as fit for purpose as we can.
And that's also, we've been doing quite a bit of work around removing barriers to elected office. So obviously this is once somebody's elected, but that is could be another barrier that the Word document, written text can be a limitation for some people, for us to bring on more diverse people.
Yeah, especially if they're got lots of jargon in them and they're perhaps not in as plain English as possible. So that is something that we are working on.
Indeed. Great. OK, I'm going to bring Willie Coffey in. He's got some questions.
Thanks very much. Good morning to you, Lorna and Sarah. I wanted to ask you a little bit more about the sanctions and sanctions process. You've partly answered one of my questions, and you've said that the sanctions available are suspension, censure and disqualification. Could you just tell us a wee bit more about how it works and whether there's a process through which a councillor might find themselves travelling through if there's repeat offences being found by the Commission? How does it work?
Yeah, so we've got a policy on the application of sanctions, and that outlines all the factors that a hearing panel will take into consideration when deciding the sanction to be imposed. And so that's got just kind of aggravating and mitigating factors in it. And so, for example, an aggravating factor would be if a councillor has perhaps been before us and a breach has been found about them about a similar issue, in say the last 5 years. A mitigating factor might be if it was a one-off incident and they'd apologised straight afterwards, or if it appeared it was inadvertent, whereas again an aggravating factor might be if it was deliberate, if it was very serious, and if it was over a long period of time. So the hearing panel, they are obliged under the Act to impose a sanction if they find a breach. So they'll look at all those. They'll look at all those factors. The respondent councillor or member has an opportunity at a hearing. Once a breach is found, the panel will come back and announce that breach decision and give brief reasons as to why they found a breach. They'll then invite that respondent councillor or member to make comments in terms of mitigation. And quite often they'll say, they'll explain, for example, what other work they do, their kind of commitment to public life, that will be taken into consideration. They'll maybe use that as a chance to apologise. They'll maybe use it as a chance to explain that the impact was fairly limited. And that will all be taken into consideration by the panel before it makes the decision on sanction.
Mm-hmm. There's no sense of the degree of sanction. So, for example, the first time an offence is recorded, it's that type of sanction. That it could be any of these three, couldn't it? Immediately. Depending on the nature of it.
Yeah, it could be. Right. I don't think it would. I think it would be very unlikely to be something like a disqualification unless it was very, very serious and prolonged, if it was just a first-time offence. I guess if it was maybe bullying and harassment over a really, really long period and the person shown no insight or whatever, then I guess it's a possibility, but I think, I mean, it would just depend on the facts and circumstances of each case.
And is there a process where a councillor can appeal against your decision, and what's your experience and how successful or otherwise those appeals may have been in the past?
Yeah, so the Act gives them an opportunity to appeal against the decision of breach, and they can also appeal against the sanction if it's a suspension or disqualification. So I've been in post, well, in fact, it doesn't really matter when I've been in post, but in the whole sort of existence of the Standards Commission, there's only been one successful appeal, and that an appeal on the same case. It ended up at the Court of Session. The Sheriff Principal found in our favour, but the Court of Session overturned that, and that was a councillor from Renfrewshire who got disqualified for a period of, I think it was 16 months was the disqualification period. He'd been before the Standards Commission twice before for similar breaches. And the Court of Session basically upheld the disqualification and said that, agreed with the Standards Commission that it shouldn't have been a brief disqualification, but the reason that they shortened the disqualification period was that they felt the Standards Commission had not taken, or the hearing panel had not taken sufficient account of the timing of the election in its written decision. Mm-hmm. So that's been the only one.
Mm. Do you find that these sanctions that are available to you are pretty much adequate to cover the kind of behaviours that you've perhaps observed over the years? Are they sufficient?
I think so. The Standards Commission members have certainly had discussions in the past couple of years, and we're hoping this is something that's in our business plan for next year. What we're going to put in our business plan for next year is to have a discussion with the Commissioner about this as well, about the possibility of seeing if the legislation could be amended to have the opportunity to maybe issue warning letters in cases where it's maybe slightly less serious, the breach has been admitted, there's the evidence isn't in dispute, to maybe, rather than going to a hearing, is to maybe sort of say, do you accept this breach by letter or correspondence or whatever? And then, if so, to maybe have some kind of warning going out that would maybe go on their record, something like that. But it's not something that we've looked at in any great detail. So, but I think that would be the only one that we've really felt that sometimes, a hearing isn't perhaps the best approach, but on the other hand, you don't want to necessarily take no action. It might be just having something slightly in between those two options.
Mm-hmm. And lastly, do you get many repeats in your experience? What are the numbers like in terms of repeat?
Actually, no, we really don't. It's very few. We've had a couple of repeat respondents before us, certainly in the time I've been in post, but it's actually been about different aspects of the code. So it might be about a failure to register, and then the second time might be
something else,
a respect or something like that. So no, it's actually quite rare.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair, who's joining us online. Marie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel, and Happy New Year. I'd like to kind of ask how the standards and complaint system in Scotland compare to those in other parts of the UK, in other countries across the world, and which systems are examples of best practice, and what can Scotland learn from them?
Yeah, certainly there isn't a kind of comparable system in England. Local authorities very much take charge of their own kind of disciplinary issues, but we do have analogous bodies in Wales and Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland, and we're in contact, especially Northern Ireland, we have quite a lot of contact with in terms of just sharing experiences, discussing matters like the extent to which freedom of expression might apply in certain cases. And we had a lot of contact with them during the pandemic when we were holding online hearings to learn about their experiences and share our experiences as well. Wider than that, across the world, I'm not so sure. I don't really know what systems there are in place.
Thank you for that. What impact has the growth of social media had on the standards of public life? The committee has heard that toxic online behaviour can be a barrier to people considering standing for local elections. What are the Commission's insight in this area, and Did the move to online council and committee meetings during COVID-19 pandemic have any impact on conduct and behaviour?
That was actually one of the questions that we asked in our survey about whether behaviours had improved or deteriorated during the COVID pandemic, and in particular in terms of online meetings. To be honest, the responses were really mixed. Some councillors and monitoring officers felt they had improved, some felt that they had deteriorated. So I guess that really is probably on a council by council basis. We actually produced an advice note on conduct at online hearings to try and help improve behaviours. We kind of saw that was maybe a gap. In terms of social media, it is problematic. We're getting, I'm sure the Commissioner will say more about this, but more and more complaints about behaviours on social media. And I think it is a barrier to representation, because obviously I think a lot of the times councillors and other people in public life are facing abuse on social media, and that's really difficult. It's completely unacceptable, but it's really difficult. But I think sometimes then it causes them to react, and then they themselves, you know, might do something that's completely disrespectful or offensive, or could be bullying and harassment. And other times I think it's a case of political point scoring sometimes, that just kind of goes beyond and beyond the kind of what might be considered acceptable and into the realms of a breach of the code. And that's what we've been doing a lot of work to try and kind of educate on that, and to try and sort of show where the line is in terms of, and trying to explain to councillors and members of public bodies as well that, you know, we really want people to lead by example. If you don't want to face abuse, then, you know, you need to lead by example in what you're posting as well. But I do think it is a barrier to representation. You know, we hear anecdotally in terms of our inquiries, but also from our surveys as well, that sometimes women councillors in particular face bullying and harassment on social media, and also from colleagues. And, you know, it's really just trying to improve that standards is what we're trying to aim at.
Thank you for that. That's me, convener.
Thanks, Marie. And Paul, you wanted to come in.
Yes, thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. It's really just to move on to the directions that were issued to the Ethical Standards Commissioner during 2021. I suppose it's just really looking for a bit of context in that regard, and what's the impacts have been since then. And we understand that the directions are there to be in place for another 2 years. I suppose it's really just, can you explain whether there needs to be a need for these directions, whether you envisage ending these at the end of that period?
Yeah, so in terms of context, there was a direction on the progress of investigations was initially issued, I think it was July 2020, to the then Commissioner. It was really because the Standards Commission wasn't getting any information, so we didn't know how quickly cases were being progressed, whether there were any delays. We didn't know whether parties to the complaints were being updated, so that direction was issued to kind of give us the comfort that was happening, that they were being progressed without any undue delays, and that parties were being updated. We then issued the outcome direction in, I think it was November 2020, and that was the direction that required the Commissioner to send all reports on all investigations to us for us to make the final decision. And that was issued because, again, there was a lack of engagement with the former Commissioner, and we were being told by a number of parties that a vast majority of complaints were being rejected at admissibility without even an investigation being undertaken, or a very limited investigation being undertaken. And so we wanted to make sure that complaints were being investigated and that they were coming to us to make the final decision on them. So we consulted with the Commissioner. Both those directions expired last year. So we consulted with the Commissioner and decided to extend the progress of investigations one for another 2 years. At the moment, we've extended the outcome direction for 3 months. I think we're waiting to see whether the committee also had...
So just to cut, what dates will these be? You know, you said 2 years and 3 months. What exact dates will that be then?
I think the outcome one, I think it's the end of February, I think it expires. Okay. but we are looking to then extend that again. And the reasons that we're looking to extend it is not because we have any concerns about the Acting Commissioner and his office. It's because we feel that it's actually been good to have a really clear separation of functions between the two organisations, with one doing investigation, one doing adjudication. We feel that essentially having a body, the Standards Commission, doing a review of all cases means that there is an independent review going on of decisions made. It also means that because we can hold hearings on cases, you know, we're taking evidence under oath or on affirmation, and it means that there's a kind of public hearing. So if there's evidence in dispute, or, for example, there's complicated issues about the application of the right to freedom of expression, those can be really discussed fully out in the open at hearing. We publish our decisions, so again, councillors and officers and members of the public can see what the threshold for a potential breach is. So for a number of reasons, we think it's the right thing for us to carry on doing that, but okay. Obviously we're interested to hear the committee's views on that as well.
I suppose the next question really is just an extension of that, and it talks around about the, I suppose, the governance and accountability between yourselves, and you talked about the ethical standards, but also the parliamentary corporate body. Are they adequate given the issues faced over the past 2 years? Are there any lessons to learn in that going forward, in terms of the broader, wider, relationships, if you like?
Yeah, I mean, we've certainly not had any difficulties with the parliamentary corporate body. They've been very supportive of us, and we have quite a lot of contact with them. Since issues arose in the Section 22 report on the Ethical Standards Commissioner was issued by Audit Scotland, we've now put a more formal arrangement in place with Office Holder Services to have governance-related updates. I think it's twice a year, I think we're doing that now. But certainly as a Standards Commission, we've not experienced any difficulties.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Paul. And Annie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. My question really just about the sort of, you'd mentioned at the beginning you have 3.1 FTE of staff to help in the role. And we know that there's a significant backlog with the Ethic Standards Commissioner in the Commission. And I was just wondering, do you believe that you have adequate budget and resources to do your role in all of this?
Yeah, just to be clear, we don't have a backlog.
I'm saying that the Ethical Standards Commission do, but do you believe that you have the right budget and that to adequately resource?
Yeah, we do. We got a kind of fourth member of staff. We changed our structure a bit a couple of years ago when the previous business manager retired. We had another look at all that and looked at our resourcing a couple of years ago and brought in a case manager at that stage, a part-time case manager, to help with the cases. But we've also kind of rejigged a lot of the way we work so that, you know, members' time, we're able to absorb those cases, looking at those decisions when they come in, the extra reports that are coming in from the Ethical Standards Commission. So, yeah, we're confident we have enough resources at the moment.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thanks, Annie. Thank and just to continue on that kind of budget question, do you think that the Ethical Standards Commission has enough budget and resourcing?
Well, my understanding is that they're recruiting four staff at the moment, and I think those staff, you know, will be in place, will hopefully clear the backlog that that they have at the investigation stage. So, you know, I know that the Acting Commissioner did a lot of work in putting together a business case. So I'm sure that, you know, I'm sure that they will get those resources in place. I mean, I think, you know, with the best will in the world, it takes a while for staff to be trained and inducted. And for, I think with investigations, you know, the more experience you have, the more understanding you get of certain cases, you know, you get faster and faster. So I don't think it's going to be an instant solution, but I've confidence it will work, yeah.
Great, thank you. And now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for joining us. I wanted to ask two questions, but firstly to go back to some of the conversations I've had with councillors around planning applications and their lack of ability to talk about them with members of the public. And I think that's one of the things councillors find incredibly challenging and members of the public also don't like. So I just wondered what your view was on that and potential reform around that, and also how many complaints relate to that kind of conversation and a breach of that.
Yeah, we've not had that many referrals on that topic to be honest, and that's something that when the codes were revised, that was a really important factor that to try and make the code a lot clearer in that regard, because councillors can have those conversations, they just can't prejudge and they can't show beforehand that they're going to support an application or an objection beforehand. So they can absolutely have those conversations and hear what people have to say, to hear their views, to hear. They just have to be very careful about not kind of prejudging the application in advance, because the code wants, what the legislation, everything that they're expected to do is on the day, is to look at the merits of the application on the day and to consider it on the day. So I think the code, the revised code, makes all that a lot clearer. I don't think the previous version of the code was that clear. Mm. So hopefully that won't be as much of an issue going forward.
Yeah, no, that's helpful, because it's something which has been raised with me, I probably think other members as well. And for many councillors, they feel they can't have these conversations. So, and are concerned that even with the revisions, this might generate more complaints about them if they do try to engage with members of the public, really.
Yeah. So we've produced, in the past, we've produced an assisting constituents card that they can hand out to their constituents to help manage expectations about what they can do. You know, and it says, for example, I can listen to you and I can listen to your views. I just can't express any view ahead of time. And we've recently produced one as well for councillors who are attending community council meetings, because I think that can be an issue. They go along to community council meetings and maybe the expectations of community councillors is that, you know, they'll almost make a decision on the spot at the community and they'll agree to support the community council's view on a planning application. And so hopefully that card that they can hand out and that they can explain to community councillors, I can't do this, hopefully that will help.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. I haven't seen those, so I don't know if you could share those with the committee at some point as well. And just finally, wondered what lessons the Commission has learnt through the COVID-19 pandemic and how you've changed your working as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think the first thing was that we found that holding online hearings was fairly successful. We're not going to go back to holding them in all cases, because we think it's important that we get out there. We hold our hearings, sorry, I should have said, in the location of where the councillor or member is based. And we think it's quite important for us to go out there for members of the public to be able to come along and watch our hearings. So we're not going to be holding, we're going to be carrying on doing that. But in terms of online hearings, if it's a case that the evidence really isn't in dispute and no witnesses are going to be called, then we will look to see whether it's more efficient to hold it online. And when we hold it online, we live stream them on our website so people can still watch. So that's something that we're looking at to try and improve our processes. In terms of kind of governance arrangements, we've gone paperless, essentially. We learned as well just better communication sometimes between the office and members. We've got a hybrid working system, you know, flexible working arrangements, all that kind of stuff as a result.
Yeah, good. Thank you. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks very much, Miles. I think that question, it was interesting to hear about the cards that you give, and I think we'd like to pick that up and promote it more. Yeah. I think it's an important tool. So that brings us to the end of our questions. I don't think anyone's got any more. So I just thank you very much for coming in and giving evidence. It's been very useful to hear it. And your opening statement was, I think, very helpful in terms of clarification between the Standards Commission and the Ethical Standards Commissioner's work. I think that was great. So I now suspend the meeting briefly while our witnesses leave the room. The third item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Ethical Standards Commissioner's annual report for 2021 to 2022 from Ian Bruce, who's the Acting Ethical Standards Commissioner, and Ian is accompanied today by Angela Glenn, who is the Senior Investigating Officer, and Karen Elder, who is the Head of Corporate Services and Accountable Officer at the Ethical Standards Commission. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite Ian to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener and members of the committee, for the invitation and the opportunity to talk to you about the work of our office. I will keep this brief because I've no doubt the committee will have a number of questions for me, for myself and my colleagues. We're going to be here to provide more detail on our work and on complaint handling and on our governance arrangements, and my colleagues will be able to assist with some of the detail in respect of both those issues. We are very keen to ensure the committee is fully informed about our performance, and we're happy to answer questions today as well as provide supplementary information by way of follow-up, whatever the committee would find helpful. I trust that you've reviewed the last two annual reports and that these will give you a flavour of the challenges that our organisation has faced since I took up office as Acting Commissioner, which is almost 2 years ago now. I don't plan a rehearsal of those challenges here, although we will be happy to respond to any questions you may have in them. I felt it may instead be more helpful at this point in time to bring the committee briefly up to speed on the current circumstances and our plans for the future. I should let you know that Audit Scotland will be laying another Section 22 report during the course of January, and that's to follow up on the progress that we've made in the usual way. We anticipate that it will reflect positively on the work we've done to rebuild our office and the services we provide and to restore confidence in the ethical standards framework. However, we also expect it to reflect the fact that more work has still to be done to embed the good practices that we have adopted since the last Section 22 report was laid by the Auditor General. In terms of the progress made, we've included all of the details on our website and in summary in our annual report. In brief, we fully implemented 11 of our auditors' recommendations and partially implemented the remainder or those that we are able to. We can provide more detail during the course of this session on all of that. We've concentrated on re-establishing our governance, our systems of assurance, our relationships with stakeholders and our staffing levels. So that gives us a firm footing, I think, for the future. In terms of my plans for the immediate future, and as Lorna, the Executive Director of the Standards Commission, mentioned, I intend to complete some additional recruitment, followed by induction, in order to clear our investigations backlog, and just as importantly, in order to process complaints much more quickly than the office ever has in the past, in our future. I'm also planning to introduce a communication strategy and develop and measure progress against key performance indicators for our office, all of which we'll be publishing further to our commitment to openness and transparency. I trust that this is of interest to the committee, and I and my colleagues are now happy to answer any questions that yourself and the members may have.
Thank you very much, Ian, and that was a very useful opening statement. I'll start with a few questions and then I'll open it up to colleagues. It was interesting to note the increase in complaints about councillors since 2015, and I'd be interested to hear if you're satisfied that the current standard system is doing enough to ensure ethical standards in public office and to deter bad behaviour.
It's a very mixed picture, I think it would be fair to say, and I'll perhaps bring Ms. Glenn in for some of the detail. But in general terms, what we've seen a rise in, and it's a steady rise, has been complaints about conduct. And the conduct that I'm referring to is specifically courtesy and respect. Having said that, we have seen a decrease in the number of complaints received in this financial year, and we can give you some of the figures for that. And we're not entirely clear whether or not that's a blip or if we're now looking at a downward trend, what we have undertaken to do is conduct some research into this area once we have the capacity for that. And we would like to have a deep dive into our statistics going back several years to try and gain a proper understanding, not just for ourselves, but, you know, for the committee and for the Standards Commission, for councils, for others with an interest in the topic and what is causing complaint numbers to rise or to fall.
Thank you, Ian. Good morning, committee members. Just to add on from what the Acting Commissioner has already laid out, taking all of our councillors' and members' cases together, they do form the bulk of the day-to-day work, the number of complaints that we get. Most of them do relate to councillors and members. Just for a snapshot of the most recent trends, there were 130 cases in the 21 to 22 year, and in the context of the financial year to date, from 2022, we are looking at about 79 cases. But we have been here before. In 2017 and 2018 financial year, there were 80 cases in total for that year. So having a lower number of cases has occurred before. But in terms of the reasons for the current downward trend, we do plan to conduct the research into understanding why the complaint volumes could fluctuate. As Ms. Johnson had referred to earlier, a high proportion of the complaints that we do get relate to conduct, and in particular conduct of councillors in social media, which is very visible. The framework in terms of additional training for councillors to make them aware that they can be readily perceived to be councillors even when using social media would always be beneficial.
So that point that you just brought up there, the need for additional training, is that something that's in the works that you're considering for making it clear to councillors that when they're on social media, they're still perceived in that role as being councillors, no matter what the conversation is?
Lorna and our team have already rolled out training of that nature, but you know, it is a revised code. And I think it's much clearer than the previous version about that. But it's a difficult area, to be honest with you. Social media being what it is, people have a mix of private and public accounts. And sometimes the lines between those become very blurred. And so it is something that I think we'll need to continue a dialogue with councils about alongside the Standards Commission, just to help people to understand that, you know, there are occasions when they may think they're operating an account that has nothing to do with their political activities, whereas because they are making comment on political matters, etc., that's how they are perceived. You know, they are being perceived as a councillor. So I think, in fairness, that's probably going to be a work in progress.
Okay, and just to broaden that out a bit, so it's interesting to hear that it's going down. The complaints are going down, and that's obviously, we've just had an election in 2022. So this is we brought in a lot of new councillors. And I'd be interested to hear what the Ethical Standards Commission has done with new councillors to ensure that they understand what is acceptable and or unacceptable bad behaviour in public office.
Sure. So again, just to reiterate the point that Ms. Johnston made, there is a separation of roles and the Standards Commission's role, and you know, we happily assist them with this. So you know, we do go to the same workshops that they've set up or that others like Solar have set up to demonstrate that we have a united front and a shared understanding of, you know, what the codes require. But it's the role of the Standards Commission to provide guidance, training and support, and our primary role is to investigate complaints. Because we report on the outcomes of all of our investigations to the Standards Commission, I think it's at that point in time that people will gain an understanding of whether or not the conduct that we've investigated does or does not represent a breach of the code, which is a decision for the Standards Commission to make.
So in effect, your work can become a case study, I think, that we've read in.
Precisely, yeah, that's a very good point, yeah.
Great, thank you. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey with some questions.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you. Ian, I just wanted to ask you, there's still large numbers of complaints that you do get that are either not pursued or investigated and aren't upheld. Could you just give us a flavour of why you do deal with so many complaints but you do not take them further forward? Is there a lack of understanding, do you think, in the public's part about what they can and can't or shouldn't complain about behaviours of local members?
That's a very interesting question and I think a good one. Far and away, the majority of the complaints that we get in are deemed to be inadmissible at stage one. We have what we call a stage two process, to be simplistic about it. Stage one is admissibility. So we have a look at the conduct that's been complained of and we take a view on whether or not the code applies to it. I'll give you a couple of simple examples. So we may have constituents who are unhappy that a councillor either isn't responding to emails or responding to emails as quickly as they would like them to, or they may have a particular local issue that they would like a councillor to take a particular approach to, but the councillor doesn't take that approach. They cast around for someone to complain to. I suppose, we have a website, we've got a complaint form that it's easy for people to complete. They land on us and we receive complaints of that nature. Those aren't admissible. The code of conduct is about the ethical conduct, again, being simplistic about it, of councillors. It's not about whether or not they are fulfilling their role in the way that, one or other disgruntled constituents feel that they should. So a lot of complaints do get ruled out on that basis simply because the code doesn't apply to them. Yeah. When we get into more nuanced cases, so ones where we do investigate, as we've already said, a lot of those do relate to discourtesy, disrespect. We do get quite a lot of those because people are saying things online that one or other members of the public find objectionable. But the fact that that particular member of the public finds it objectionable doesn't necessarily mean that it's been disrespectful. Again, to give you maybe a concrete example, there are debates going on in the country that are quite polarised, political debates. Now, the fact that I, as a constituent, disagree with your position on the side of, a particular political debate, the fact that I disagree with you doesn't necessarily mean that what that councillor has said online is inherently disrespectful. But, we would need to investigate that just to establish whether or not that's the case. And some can be a wee bit borderline. The other thing that we need to take account of, and again, Ms. Johnson mentioned this, and it's not on the face of the code, but we need to take account of people's right to freedom of political expression. Article 10.2 of the European Convention on Human Rights. So sometimes people will say something that people find objectionable, and on its face, it could appear to be discourteous or disrespectful. There is enhanced protection for politicians by virtue of that convention right. There are occasions where we determine that that is applicable and that a breach of the code cannot be found as a consequence.
Mm-hmm. And in closing down a complaint, do you inform the complainer about the decision that you've taken and why you've reached that decision, and perhaps the issue that they're complaining about is not really within scope of the work that you do?
Indeed, and we're planning to go further, in fact, than we have done previously by providing full reports. They do receive written decisions and I provide reasons for my decisions. That happens in relation to all my work, but we're planning to go further on that, perhaps. Mm-hmm. I can ask Angela to give a bit more detail.
Yes, certainly. So at the end of the stage one process, once we have considered the assessment of the complaint against all of our admissibility criteria, which is informed by the 2000 Act, but also by the eligibility direction of the Standards Commission, Once that process is done and we consider that this complaint cannot proceed to stage two investigation, then we would draft a decision letter that is shared with the complainer. In the future, in the very near future, we will be sharing a copy of that letter with the respondent as well to inform them that we had received this complaint and this is the reasoning why it was not taken forward to stage two investigation.
Mm, that's good. Great. Now, I really have to ask you about the 2019-20 and 2021 period where the numbers of complaints not taken forward was excessively high. It was over 80%, and that possibly gave rise to the Audit Scotland Section 22 that we all know about. Can you tell us, insofar as you can, anything about why that was so high at that period? And could you also give the committee some kind of sense about why that cannot, those complaints that came at that period of time can't be reinvestigated?
Sure. A challenging question, to be honest with you. So the decisions that were being taken at the time were being taken by my immediate predecessor, and I think that's also relevant to your follow-up question. She was the commissioner. She was exercising her judgment as she saw it at the time, and what that meant was that a number of complaints were dismissed early. And a number of complaints were investigated, but no breach found, and that's just the reality. We've seen a return, and again, Ms. Glenn will be able to give you the figures. So, you know, we are now at a stage where investigation rates, admissibility rates, are pretty much comparable with the 10 years of prior commissioners. You know, you get a new commissioner in post, they're a statutory office holder and they will conduct the role in the way in which they see fit. I mean, that's just the reality once someone is appointed to a post of that nature. I do understand that some people are disgruntled, that there wasn't perhaps an investigation in their case, or that there was an investigation and a breach of the code was not found. They've been in touch with the office to discuss those things with me. And I've been very open with them about what I am and I'm not able to do. The committee will be aware from the Section 22 report, there was a recommendation that we should have complaints from the period from August, prior to the, my immediate predecessor departing, up to March when she went on leave, that those all the complaints looked at during that period should be independently looked at again. We felt that we needed to take legal advice on that recommendation, and we did, and we've been happy to share that legal advice with the SPCB with our auditors, just to explain why we felt that we couldn't take it forward. And I'd be happy to share it with the committee in confidence as well. I've been very open about this. The legal advice was unequivocal, and it was to the effect that it's not, I'm not going to say not possible, that it would be unlawful for me, except in very narrow circumstances, to reinvestigate complaints where another commissioner had already reached a decision on them. The legal principle involved is called functus officio. I don't want to get into Latin here, but perhaps an equivalent term might be helpful to the committee. You'll be familiar with the concept of double jeopardy, which is where you basically can't be brought before the court for potential conviction for the same crime twice, except in very, again, narrow circumstances. The narrow circumstances in which I could revisit complaints would be if there's been a fundamental mistake of fact, if there's been fraud, or if the public authority, as in this case the Commissioner, had not completed her investigation. If those circumstances don't apply, I fundamentally cannot reopen closed cases. And there is a natural justice aspect to this, because looking at it from the other side, for those who, you know, complaints against them weren't upheld, I suppose they would now be in the position of feeling, I've been exonerated, how on earth can a, you know, another commissioner 2 years down the line come in and then, you know, reinvestigate me for something when, from my perspective, I've been cleared. I don't know if that helps or explains fully what the situation is.
It helps a great deal, Ian.
Good.
And thank you so much for taking the time to give us that detail. Maybe just a final question from me is, what recourse is there for a person making a complaint who perhaps feels that their complaint has been inappropriately dismissed at the initial stages? Where do they turn to?
Yes, judicial review is the option open to them. But again, just to be clear, I am very receptive as a commissioner, as are all the staff in the office, to discussions with people, you know, to gain a proper understanding about why they feel that the decision I may have made initially is a wrong one. And there are several junctures during the investigation process where they have an opportunity to make their views clear to me. And I am more than happy to listen to them. And there are occasions on which something that they say to me will lead me to draw a different conclusion.
Okay, right. Thank you so much for that. Thanks very much, Convener.
Thanks for the yes. Those were very helpful responses. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair, who is joining us online.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. The committee is keen to continue to explore the possible barriers to local elected office. Is there any evidence that the complaint system in Scotland may be deterring people from standing or re-standing, for example, from local elected office? What impact does the process have on those councillors being investigated? And is there support in place to help councillors during the process? There is evidence of vexatious complaints being made, and if so, what more can be done to discourage these?
Okay, so I think we have three questions, which I'll try to address in turn. I think the first one you'd asked was whether or not the framework in Scotland potentially represents a barrier. I am not sure that the framework does. I think the framework, if operated properly by all participants, should be something that would encourage people into public life, because it does encourage good conduct on the part of councillors, board members. So to that extent, I think it's something that should encourage people as opposed to put them off. I think the thing that does put people off is conduct. I've already mentioned there are some quite polarised debates going on in Scotland, and you know, and there's no issue with that. You know, that's one of the hallmarks of a well-operating democracy. But the way in which people express themselves sometimes, I mean, it's even gotten to levels where some of the debates have been described as toxic. Now, that certainly can be off-putting to people. I don't know if the committee's aware that the Local Government Association did some research just recently, so over 2020-21, and produced a report in June of last year. And it was about the impact, I think it was entitled Debate, Not Hate, the impact of conduct on democracy. And some very interesting findings in it apply to England and Wales and not Scotland. But some of the findings, for example, people were targeted because of their particular characteristics online. So misogyny was a feature, homophobia was a feature, racism was a feature. And if you're concerned about the under-reflection of people with protected characteristics in public life, then that's certainly something that we should all be alive to. And it was also clear from what respondents were saying that those activities were putting people off from either standing for election, considering standing for election. Anecdotally in Scotland, because I receive complaints from councillors who are subject to some of this conduct, I do know that these things happen. And I also know anecdotally that that councillors, they've said to me, I don't plan to stand again. I won't be encouraging others to do so because of the, you know, the treatment that I've had. Now, again, that, you know, that is something that should be of concern to all of us, particularly if we're concerned about the diversification of local authorities. It's one of the things I'm very passionate about with my public appointments hat. It's very important that boards are diverse, and I'm sure the same thing holds true of councils in order to fulfil their roles as well as they possibly can. So, yes, there are issues there. You had asked about vexatious complaints, and they do come up as well. And again, you know, I do see the personal impact of those on councillors. Perhaps, again, another concrete example. So I have seen a neighbour of a councillor submit a complaint to us alleging a contravention of the code. And it was fundamentally about weaponising the code, for want of a better expression, because of a neighbourhood dispute. It had, you know, nothing to do with the councillor acting in that capacity. I'm not going to say that happens particularly frequently, but it does happen. Mm-hmm. And of course, occasionally complaints are politically motivated, so we do see tit for tat complaints sometimes, where political parties are in dispute locally and use the code in order to gain some sort of leverage over others.
Thank you. As an ex-councillor, I can tell you how toxic the council chambers can be at times. You know, it's appalling, the behaviour of some folk. Of the 330 complaints received about councillors and board members in 2021-2022, 99 were complaints about disrespect towards employees or the public. Could you provide more information on this figure and the definition of disrespect, and also what percentage of complaints relates to interactions on social media?
I don't know if Angela is able to help with the breakdown. It may be that we don't have a full breakdown for you today, but we can certainly get one for you. So to answer your question, what constitutes disrespect, we always refer to the Standards Commission's guidance note on this, and it's particularly helpful. But it varies significantly, and perhaps it's the reason that people come forward more frequently with complaints of that nature than any other, because it is quite a broad concept in comparison with declaration of interests, you know, whether or not it's treated me with courtesy and respect. You know, people can much more readily understand what that means, you know, a member of the public can, which is possibly one of the reasons that we get more complaints of that nature. But it can mean a number of different things, and we always look at, you know, the particular circumstances. We look at the advice notes, and we make a determination thereafter about whether or not the code is engaged. Bullying and harassment is probably easier to define, but again, you know, there's a very fulsome advice note on what constitutes bullying and harassment. And we also use all the Standards Commission's decisions about whether or not a breach has been found as precedents for our own decision making when, you know, when we review cases, and our reports refer to prior decisions so that people are helped to understand why we've reached the conclusion that we have. I am particularly concerned by the number of complaints made by staff, although it's much lower than the number of complaints, to be honest with you, made by members of the public and by councillors. So, you know, that's kind of the pecking order. There's members of the public first, then councillors. Staff members are much lower. But I do, I am very open to have discussions with council officers. They do get in touch with the office, and I have made it absolutely clear that, you know, if they want to make a complaint, and they don't take that lightly, because that can be a career damaging thing to do, is to make a complaint as a council officer, a senior council officer. But I do make it clear that if they come to us with a complaint of that nature, it will be properly investigated, and I've absolutely committed to doing that.
Thank you. Obviously, I'd asked about what percentage of complaints relate to interaction on social media. If you don't have that at hand, could maybe you forward that on to the committee? Just to be helpful. Thank you.
By all means, yeah, we'll do that analysis for you.
Thanks very much for that. I think that would also be useful. Social media seems to be an area that is causing problems. Now I'm going to bring in Annie Wells.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. It seems as if it's been a long day. First day back after the new year. The ESC website currently states the initial review time is 9 months. I know you said in your opening statement that you are in the process of doing recruitment and induction, but I was just wondering if you could give us a bit more information on why we're at this stage, whether things are improving now or when are we likely to see an improvement in the sort of wait times, and also are these wait times causing complainants to sort of not pursue the complaints? That's the sort of a first part. And obviously, given this backlog has been going on for several years, I know you're only in the role 2 years yourself, but do you believe that the Commissioner's Office does have enough budget and staff to do the job properly? Thank you.
So I'll talk in general terms about this, and I'll bring Angela in so you've got some facts and figures. Where do I start? Maybe let's go back to the past. Why do we have a backlog? We had significant staff turnover during the tenure of my immediate predecessor. I'll tell you how stark it is. None of the investigatory staff who were in post during Bill Thompson's time, so that was, you know, the commissioner prior to my immediate predecessor, none of the investigatory staff are in post anymore. None of them. So that's an entire investigatory team replaced. The commissioner did go out and recruit, but lost those staff also. So turnover was a perpetual problem for us. You know, like 70-80%. So one of the first things I had to do was recruit into vacant posts, and I started work on that as soon as I came into post. And that's happened, and we've basically done away with staff turnover. You know, we have a steady, happy and effective workforce. The new investigatory team members had completed their first year by October of last year. I've been monitoring the situation constantly. Now, you know, turnover was the reason the backlog built up, because there was nobody to investigate complaints. It's sadly that straightforward. So I could see that we were getting through them. But equally, it didn't look as though we were having any impact on the backlog. So notwithstanding all the other staff pressures that the staff were under, I said we need to bring forward a workforce planning exercise. We need to establish how many people we need in order to fulfil all our roles as effectively as we would like to. And that includes not just clearing the backlog, but getting better at what we do for the future so that people don't have long waiting times.
Yeah.
So we did all that. We completed that workforce planning exercise last May, and it was really comprehensive. We put a business bid into the SPCB straight away. You'll know what it's like, recess and the rest. But eventually I managed to get some time in front of the SPCB in October. The case was really quickly granted thereafter. And we started recruitment at the end of last year, so prior to going on the Christmas break, when people have a think about their future. We think we've made a good offer. You know, come and work for a really significant public sector organisation that values people, that values the people that that work with it. And closing dates are towards the end of this month, so we'll have people in post. They'll need to be inducted. Once they're up to speed, then we'll get them on clearly onto the backlog. We've put lots of other measures in place. So you're asking about the impact in the interim. So, again, we've been monitoring this situation really, really constantly. We decided as a senior management team, it was only fair to let people know. We've said on our website, you know, there is currently a backlog. We've seen no evidence since we put that banner up that complaint volumes have fallen. So that would suggest to me that it's not putting people off necessarily. But there were lots of other things that we felt that we could do in order to bring the backlog down and to investigate more effectively, even though we had it in place. I'll maybe get Angela to talk to the detail of some of the things that she and her team have put in place.
Yeah, certainly. I think Ian has already covered the majority of the actions that we are taking. It may be helpful for me to kind of give you a breakdown of how our year is progressing. So we began the current financial year in April 22 with around 60 cases sitting at admissibility stage. And throughout the year, between 50 to 60 cases were at assessment stage throughout that period from April to October of 22. At the same time, the number of active ongoing investigations per month remains at very high levels compared to similar periods from the last 5 years. And the number of reports that we've issued to the Standards Commission per the outcome direction, which Ms. Johnson referred to earlier, that also represents the highest number of reports ever sent through. Currently, we are looking at 33 cases at assessment stage for councillors' complaints. We are assessing cases dated up to June of 22. Mm-hmm. And this, you would note that this is a significant step forward in terms of bringing down those numbers from starting at 60 cases at beginning of the year down to 33 now. The reasons for this is due to various measures that we have put in place, some of which Ian has already mentioned, but just to go into some of the detail on that, the team has actively committed to allocating themselves to that number of backlog cases up to June 22. We are now moving beyond that. They are doing this despite having a heavy investigation workload, and it is a huge... I cannot thank the team enough, and I want to go on public record to say just how proud I am of the struggle that we have gone through to reach the stage that we are at now. We are actively keeping to a triage system where cases that are not within our remit, that does not match the eligibility direction, these are dismissed first, and these are part of the letters that I referred to when answering Mr. Coffey's question. With these, we continue to see that our triage cases now are up to date. We do not require to inform complainers, that we have not been able to reach back to you, because we do, and we have already seen the numbers go down in terms of cases that can be triaged, and we will keep that going. We also preserve evidence. We have a very extensive plan to preserve as much evidence as possible to prevent loss through the passage of time as we work through this backlog. These includes requesting and saving webcast meetings, social media, screenshots, which we will save to the file, online articles, and this all saves time once we have allocated an investigating officer to the case so that they can have all the material to hand to complete assessment. As Ian mentioned, we have also completed workforce planning, and this planning took into consideration as a priority the resources that we would need to get through the complaints as quickly as we can. And as he's mentioned, recruitment is already underway. Throughout this, we also have very open and transparent communication. The backlog banner indicates 9 months, but that's because it is taking into account the worst case scenario, which is an outlier case from January that we have not yet been able to close. But in reality, the amount of time that it takes for an assessment to take place is approximately 13 weeks. So if we are looking at a number of cases now and the progress that we have already made in bringing the backlog numbers down, we should be looking at being able to clear the backlog within 4 to 6 months.
Excellent. Thank you very much, and thanks for everything, all the hard work you're doing to bring this process back to sort of a time frame that we would require. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much. Paul, you want to come in?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Ian, I wanted to bring you back to the Section 22 report, which was issued, and you kind of touched on this. There was two key things, I think, came out. One was the key relationships with other public bodies have broken down, and you touched a little bit on that. The other one was mentioned around about the other generals also concluded that the Ethical Standards Commissioner Office was neither open nor transparent. I just wonder if you want to talk just a little bit more on these two issues and what's kind of going on. You've kind of touched on it, but just in a little bit more detail, if that's okay.
Yes. I might briefly talk about stakeholder engagement, but Karen is wholly across corporate services as well as governance, so I might bring her in because... Karen's the one who keeps our website regularly up to date. We, this probably is relevant openness and transparency, but how we're doing against the recommendations, that's all online and published. Yeah. So, you know, everyone's aware of precisely where we are. I'll cover stakeholder engagement briefly and then I'll turn to Karen. But it was one of the first things I did, was trying to rebuild bridges with all of our stakeholder organisations. As soon as I took up post, I was in touch with the Standards Commission, which was clearly a key stakeholder and where the relationship had broken down, I think, completely. But also the likes of COSLA, SOLAR, SOLAS, Scottish ministers, you name it. We have a very long list of very important stakeholders, and it was important that I was in touch with them quickly. And it wasn't just to say, how you doing, and, you know, like, I'm now in post. It was to say, I understand that our office has some significant issues, that you will have had concerns about it. This is an opportunity for you to articulate those, for you to help me to understand what we need to do to improve, for me to give you commitments to improving in all of those areas. Trust doesn't come automatically. You know, again, I made it clear, you know, I don't expect you to trust me from day one. You will need to see actions on top of words. So I'll maintain regular contact with you, but you're always pushing on an open door. You know, everyone, I think, from all our stakeholder groups knows all they need to do is pick up the phone if they've got any concerns or questions about the way in which we're operating. And I will have a chat with them about how we're getting on and what we can do to fix any concerns that they may have. So you know, that's in very general terms, but I'll maybe turn to Karen now for some specifics on our transparency. Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. When releasing a Section 22 report on our 2021 audit, the Auditor General noted that there was an absence of openness and transparency in the organisation. And since then, we have undertaken a range of activities to become a more open and transparent organisation. Foremost was the development of a new strategic plan. That began in April 2021 when the Acting Commissioner was appointed. That clearly sets out our values that we will work to, and it was the subject of a full public consultation and then was laid before Parliament in October 21. We carried out a full review of our complaint handling statistics and published the results in our annual report and accounts for 2020-21. We have formal and detailed minutes of our monthly senior management team meetings. Those are published. We publish our business plans and our progress against our business plan. As Ian's already mentioned, we publish the progress against the auditor's recommendations. We've consulted both formally and informally on the investigations manual. With the full public consultation recently closing. In future, as already mentioned, we are planning to publish our reports and decision letters relating to conduct complaints. The Commissioner is open to meeting, and indeed has met, with those who have complained about us. In fact, we have published the outcome of an external investigation into a significant complaint about us. The Commissioner is open to meeting and has met with any council officer who wishes to talk about the work of the office. On an internal basis, staff input is sought when developing our business plans, and we have also brought them into identifying risks to the business. And we keep up to date with them with regular team and individual meetings. That's a flavour of where we've got to on transparency.
You can. That's really helpful. That's really helpful. Thank you. I have no further questions.
No further questions
at this stage, unless Ian wants to come back. And Ian, I don't know if you want to come back in on that, but that's been really helpful. So.
suppose just to reiterate the point I made during my opening statement, and I say this to every parliamentary committee that I appear before, engagement with you is important. We have few opportunities to talk publicly about our work, so you know we genuinely appreciate this opportunity, but the committee shouldn't hesitate to ask at any time for any information that it feels it would find helpful. And if we don't have it to hand and it requires a bit of research, we're more than happy to do it.
I was also previously on the Standards Committee where you presented as well, and that came across quite clearly.
Good.
So, thanks for that. Mm.
Yeah, thank you. I'm going to bring in Miles with a question. Yeah.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to ask a question with regards to the directions to the Ethical Standards Commissioner, which were issued during 2020-21. And could you explain to the committee in more detail about the impact of these directions and also their ongoing application as well?
Sure. So you've already heard from Ms. Johnson from the Standards Commission, and as I said myself, I think it was wholly understandable that those directions came in, and they came in for a very good reason. There is a separation of functions between the two offices, and I think having those directions in place, so it makes it clear what those different functions are. I think potentially we could make it clearer to the public what those are, and I have plans for that as well. So yes, they do have an impact, but I think their operation does provide a great deal of public assurance that, you know, what happened previously perhaps couldn't happen again. Mm-hmm. There are three sets of directions, and you know, their impact varies. We have to keep everyone up to date. I'm being simplistic about this, but you know, the first one is about keeping everyone up to date. That's something we'd commit to anyway. It's written into our manual. It's the right thing to do, is to keep everyone up to date with the progress of an investigation. So it wouldn't matter whether direction was in place or not. That, you know, that's something that we'd commit to continuing. The second direction is to do with reporting, and yes, you know, it has meant that we are reporting more frequently than perhaps prior commissioners to the commission. But as Ms. Johnson explains, final decisions on whether or not a breach have occurred statutorily is for the commission to make, and you know, they can't make those decisions without a well set out report. Probably worth saying as well, the template letters, the template reports, the fact sheets that go to members of the public, we've agreed all these things with the Standards Commission to ensure that we are on the same page and that everyone knows what to expect from the process. The last one was the one that was issued just prior to my immediate predecessor's departure, and that's the eligibility direction. And that's perhaps the one that gives me least leeway in terms of, you know, like determining whether or not an investigation should be taken forward, because basically what it requires is, if on its face there could be a breach of the code, except in very, you know, narrow circumstances, then we do have to investigate it, and then clearly on the back of that we need to report. So it does mean that live investigations, the levels are higher, I think, than they've been historically. We're probably, again, you know, we're monitoring what we're up to, but we think probably this year, average of 22 live investigations per month, which is quite a record level. So yes, they do have an impact, but it'll be for the committee and the public to decide whether or not, you know, it's worth it in order to ensure that we have that level of assurance.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. And I think for, you know, the oversight role we have, it'd be helpful with the plans you're saying being taken forward, maybe to provide some updates on when they're being implemented and things. I think that'd be helpful.
Yes, of course.
To see. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. Ian, in your opening statement, you talked about a comms strategy. You may have covered some of that in our question, in your response to our questions, but I just wanted to give you an opportunity to share a little bit more about that. And also, you mentioned KPIs, key performance indicators for the office. So it'd be interesting to hear both a bit about both of those.
Yes, of course. So Members will be aware that one of the recommendations of our auditors was that we should obtain internal audit services. So, you know, we did tender for and obtain internal audit services. And one of their recommendations was, you know, having looked at all the work that we do, and I'll maybe actually ask Karen to give you some detail on how we've done in terms of our first internal audit, because we had them have a look at three topics this year, which hopefully will provide you with a bit more assurance about our work, because it's not me marking my own homework, it's someone who we've commissioned to have a look at how we're getting on. But they said, as well as your overall strategy, you should have a think about a communication strategy. And having reflected on it, we felt that that's a recommendation that we'd certainly like to take forward. So we're aware of the work that we do. You're aware of the work that we do. I am not sure that the general public necessarily is, or what the difference between our office is and that of the Standards Commission. I'd said earlier, I think proper operation of the ethical standards framework should actually encourage more people into public life, be that, you know, as a board member or standing for elected office. So I think that we have a role to educate the public about the framework, where we sit in it. And my initial plans, I was having a look at this yesterday, is we do have that strategic plan. And I think the things that are important that the public need to know is, what's our purpose, what are our objectives, and what are our values. And so communicating all of that to the public and to our stakeholders, and making it clear where they can come and, you know, how they can make complaints, making that whole process more accessible. So that's certainly what I'm thinking about in that particular area. KPIs, we've got two sets. I'm not going to say they're entirely distinct, but they are a bit dissimilar. The first set of KPIs, and possibly the ones that are most important to people who are going through the process, be that as a complainer or a respondent, is how quickly we can get through the process. And they were all included in the manual for consultation. But the other set of KPIs I'd mentioned earlier, you know, what I'm planning to say in terms of our communication strategy, because we have values and because we have objectives, I mean, basically we've set out our stall. It's not just about this is what we'll do, but it's also about how we'll go about it. Mm-hmm. And that's a bit softer. I've been used to running applicant surveys on an anonymous basis for the public appointments process for years and years. I'm going to adopt something similar. So when we write at the end of the process to complainers and respondents, they'll get a link to an anonymous survey, and they'll be asked to tell us what their experience of the process was for them, and they'll not be identifiable unless they choose to give us information that would identify them. The other thing that I'm planning to do, and perhaps the committee may have a view on this, so we currently gather demographic data on applicant surveys. I'd like to do the same thing for complainers and respondents. And it's simply because I don't think we have a handle in Scotland on what the demographics of local authorities are, but equally whether or not... So we can use the census data for comparison, but also to get a sense of whether or not, for example, you know, more complaints are made about women councillors, that type of thing. I think it would be helpful to have data in that area. And it's about informing future policy and procedures for ourselves, but also for the Standards Commission and for others with an interest. I'll maybe ask Karen very briefly just to talk about internal audit results.
Yes, as Ian said, we appointed an internal audit function back in the spring of 2022. Their first audit that they carried out for us was in the summer last year, and that was looking at our governance arrangements as they stood at that time. We were pleased that they reported we had substantial controls in place and identified seven good practice points. They did have 9 recommendations for us, which is above the sort of industry benchmark, but they were 3 medium ones and 6 low-level recommendations, all of which were tied to sort of the administrative implementation of those recommendations already set out by our external auditor. They also looked at our risk management procedures and concluded there was strong controls in place, again with 7 good practice points and 4 low-level recommendations, which again were administrative in nature, how we set out a risk register. We took the opportunity for them to look at the investigation manual that we were developing while it was still in the consultation phase. And again, they noted there were substantial controls in place in coming through the investigation manual, and there was 10 good practice points against industry. So we were really pleased to see that, and congratulations to Ms Glenn and her team on that. And there was 1 medium recommendation and a low priority one as well. So we were very pleased to see the progress that was being examined and validated externally through those reports.
Thank you very much for that, Karen. Yeah, it's great to hear the positive direction with your internal audits, and I'm sure you are very pleased about that. And that's come to the end of our questions, I think. Nobody else looking to ask anything more. So I wanted to thank you for coming to give evidence today. And I think from certainly what I've heard, it seems to me that you are modelling a good leadership in connection with the 9 key principles that underpin the standards expected in public life. And I think that's something that we all need to do, isn't it? It's modelling it. Modelling the direction of travel that we need to be going in. And that's certainly what I've heard from what you've been sharing with the committee today. So I'd also like to wish you well with your recruitment process. And we will be seeing you. I hear you. We can contact you at any time, but we will be seeing you probably around this time next year. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. Thank you.
Okay, we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the remainder of our agenda items in private. So as we have no more public business today, I now close the public part of the meeting.